Good evening.
Good evening.
And welcome to another lecture sponsored by the Institute of Divine Metaphysical Research. This is a school and not a church. And neither are we affiliated with any religious organizations. This school is a non-profit, non-denominational, scientific, and research organization dedicated to showing proof and existence of Yahweh our Elohim and the operation of his eternal purpose, pattern, and plan operating throughout eternity until this present day. This school was founded as a result of divine vision and revelation given to our founder, Dr. Henry Clifford Kelly, in the state of Ohio in the year of 1931. The school was incorporated in the state of California in the year 1958. Since that time, we have established branch schools throughout the United States and in certain foreign countries. The Ontario branch was established in May of 1988. Now, in this school, we teach about the true and original names and titles of the Father, the Word of Son, and the Holy Spirit as contained in the original Hebrew text. The true name of the Father is Yahweh. It has been improperly substituted by Lord. The true title of the Word or Son is Elohim. It has been improperly substituted by God. The true name of the Holy Spirit manifested in or out of a physical body is Yahshua. It has been erroneously substituted by Jesus Christ. Now, Lord and God are titles. They are not names. As the Apostle Paul, filled with the Holy Spirit, tells us in 1 Corinthians 8 and 5, there are Lord's many and there is God's many. But we now know that every Lord must have a name and every God must have a name also. Elohim is a title, but unlike Lord and God, Elohim is a divine title. This means this is the title that our Father Yahweh chose for himself. Now, Jesus is a name, but it is an erroneous name. A minor investigation on your part in any good dictionary or encyclopedia will prove to you that neither the Hebrew language, the Greek language, or the Latin language have any letters or characters in their alphabet that will produce the sound that is made by this letter J. Neither was there a letter J in any other language until some 1400 years after the Messiah's death. Therefore, such names as Jesus and Jehovah are impossible rendering of the true and correct name of our Father and his Son. Christ is a title just like Lord and God. Now, Yahweh is pure spirit, and in this state, he is incomprehensible and inscrutable. He is the ultimate source, substance, limits, and bounds of everything. We have Yahweh symbolized on this chart as a fiery cloud. Now, Yahweh is not a cloud. He merely chose a cloud to symbolize himself because the cloud has no particular or descriptive shape or form. We have drawn this cloud all around the edges of this chart to show you how that everything on this chart abides within the cloud. In like manner, everything in the universe abides within the pure spirit state of Yahweh. Now, Yahweh, knowing that man could not perceive of him in his pure spirit state, took on shape and took on form right within himself as Elohim. This is the Word or Son, a super incorporeal being, that is, having the shape and form of a man, but without flesh and blood. This spirit form can only be seen in divine visions and understood in divine revelations. This self-same spirit later manifested in a physical body and walked the earth plane as Yahshua the Messiah, on whom the world calls Jesus Christ. There is only one name unto salvation, and we should all know that name. So the simple and yet intelligent question we should all ask ourselves is, what was the name of the Savior during the time that he walked the earth plane? A further understanding of this name and title may be held by reading the preface of the Holy Name Bible. Also in this school, we teach by a divine pattern of the universe. It is called the divine pattern because it is Yahweh's pattern. After Yahweh led the children of Israel out of the land of Egypt, he called Moses atop Mount Sinai and showed him this tabernacle pattern in a vision. He later instructed him to build one in the wilderness exactly like the one that he saw on the mount. Now the tabernacle have a most holy place, and a holy place, and a court around about. These three compartments make up the one tabernacle pattern. We're going forth to show proof in this school how that everything in the universe is made and operates according to the structure and function of this threefold tabernacle pattern, and that absolutely nothing escapes the pattern. The primary aim and objectives of the school are as follows. First, to help you find and know Yahweh, our Elohim, as He really is and as He has exists. Second, is to form a nucleus of universal brotherhood of humanity in Yahshua Messiah, with distinction of race, nationality, creed, caste, sex, or color. Third, is to investigate the unexplained spirit law or the so-called laws of nature and the powers latent in man. Fourth, is to encourage and promote the study of the scriptures compared to religions, psychology, philosophy, modern practical, and occult sciences. Sixth is to learn, know, and understand Yahweh's eternal purpose through the dispensations and ages. Seventh is to discern, avoid being deceived by Lucifer, the serpent, the devil, the dragon, or Satan and his demons operating the mystery of iniquity on earth through the dispensations of time. And eighth is to honestly contend for the common salvation and faith which was once delivered to the sons or children of Yahweh. And ninth is to make known that Yahweh from the beginning ordained there is no other name given among men whereby man must be saved, saving the name of Yahshua Messiah. And tenth is to inherit eternal life now in the kingdom of Yahshua Messiah with the hope of immortal glorification in the new earth state. Our watchword is peace, and our slogan is to speak the truth. We're going to start this morning, this evening class, with the prayer of Dr. Samuel Salas. And we have a scripture lesson. It's going to be Genesis, the first chapter, by Dr. Eunice Roger.
Good evening, Miss.
Good evening.
It's time for prayer. Thank you, Almighty Yahweh, for all the blessings you pour to us every day, every second, every minute. We are so blessed having this teaching, and keep us feeding with all this understanding, wisdom, and knowledge we need. The times is getting close.
Yeah.
Every time we start getting most of the people old, and I hope you keep us strong and with a flame of the desire to be here every day. There is the doors open. I say all those things in your own sign name, Yahshua the Messiah. Let us all say, Hallelujah.
Hallelujah. And we'll also have a selection of music. Go ahead and start the music.
Yeah. evening, class. Scripture lesson will be taken from Genesis, the first chapter, and I'll be reading from the Holy Name Bible containing the Holy Name version of the Old and New Testament, critically compared with ancient authorities and various manuscripts, revised by the late A.B. Trainer, Scripture Research Association, Incorporated. Genesis, the first chapter. In the beginning, Elohim created the heavens and the earth, and the earth became without form and void, and darkness was upon the face of the deep, and the Spirit of Elohim moved upon the face of the waters. And Elohim said, Let there be light, and there was light. And Elohim saw the light, that it was good. And Elohim divided between the light and between the darkness. And Elohim called the light day, and the darkness he called night. And the evening and the morning were the first day. And Elohim said, Let there be a firmament in the midst of the waters, and let it separate the waters from the waters. And Elohim made the firmament, and divided the waters which were under the firmament from the waters which was above the firmament, and it was so. And Elohim called the firmament heaven, and the evening and the morning were the second day. And Elohim said, Let the waters under the heavens be gathered together unto one place, and let the dry land appear. And it was so. And Elohim called the dry portion earth, and the gathering together of the waters called he seas. And Elohim saw that it was good. And Elohim said, Let the earth bring forth tender grass, the herb yielding seed, the fruit trees yielding fruit after his kind, whose seed is in itself upon the earth. And it was so. And the earth brought forth tender grass, herb yielding seed after his kind, and the tree yielding fruit, whose seed was in itself after his kind. And Elohim saw it was good. And the evening and the morning were the third day. And Elohim said, Let the lights in the firmament of the heavens separate the day from the night, and they will be for signs and for seasons and for days and for years. And let them be for light in the firmament of the heavens to give light upon the earth. And it was so. And Elohim made to appear two great lights, the greater light to rule the day, and the lesser light to rule the night, and the stars. And Elohim set them in the firmament of the heaven to lighten the earth, and to rule by day and by night, and to separate between light and between darkness. And Elohim saw that it was good. And the evening and the morning were the fourth day. And Elohim said, Let the waters swarm with swarms of living creatures, and birds that may fly above the earth in the open firmament of the heavens. And Elohim created great sea monsters, and every living creature that swarmed with which the waters swarmed after their kind, and every winged bird after his kind. And Elohim saw that it was good. And Elohim blessed them, saying, Be fruitful and increase, and fill the waters and the seas, and let the birds multiply in the earth. And the evening and the morning were the fifth day. And Elohim said, Let the earth bring forth the living creature after his kind, cattle and creeping things, and the beasts of the earth after their kind. And it was so. And Elohim made the beasts of the earth after their kind, and cattle after their kind, and everything that creepeth upon the ground after their kind. And Elohim saw it was good. And Elohim said, Let us make man in our image, after our likeness, and let them rule over the fish of the sea, and over the birds of the heavens, and over the cattle, and over all the earth, and over every creeping thing that creeps upon the earth. So Elohim created man in his image. In the image of Elohim created he him. Male and female created he him. And Elohim blessed him, and Elohim said unto him, Be fruitful, and multiply, and replenish the earth, and subdue it, and rule over the fish of the sea, and over the birds of the heavens, and over every living thing that move upon the earth. And Elohim said, Behold, I have given you every herb bearing seed, which is upon the face of all the earth, and every tree, and the which is the fruit of a tree yielding seed. To you it shall be for food. And to every beast of the earth, and to every bird of the heavens, and to every creeping thing upon the earth, wherein there is life, I have given every green herb for food. And it was so. And Elohim saw everything that he had made, and behold, it was very good. And the evening and the morning were the sixth day. Thus the heavens and the earth were completed, and all their hosts. And on the seventh day Elohim completed his work which he had made, and he rested on the seventh day from all his work which he had made. And Elohim blessed the seventh day and sanctified it, because that in it he had rested from all his works which Elohim created and made. I have read the first chapter of Genesis. Let us all say, Hallelujah.
Hallelujah. Before we call our first speaker, I want to acknowledge our guest tonight by Don
Alex Martinez.
Alex Martinez, which is a guest of Dr. Samuel Salas. This is the first time visitor. We want to say to you, I hope that something is said here to inspire you. Want to come back and study with us. If you have any questions, you let us know. In most cases, all you got to do is sit down and listen, and most of the questions, your question will be answered.
Mm-hmm.
It's not at the time that you might want to ask a question. If you do be still, your question will be answered.
Yes.
But I hope you enjoy coming here and studying with us. Have a seat, please. Now, this all is Gentleman Rollins from Prosper. Now, Lord Loveless is our treasurer. He's out for the night. He's not feeling well. And Iggy Ignacio, him and his wife is out on vacation for a couple of weeks. They should be back next Tuesday night. Anyway, we're going to have a two-speaker format tonight. Our first speaker tonight is going to be Dr. Samuel Salas.
Since we have a new guest, I want to be clear and substantial. And I want to go into the names, because the people that grew up in the Catholic Church, I presume he is from there, they are not familiar with those names, I wasn't familiar with those names. And those names, they were something I can say I never heard before those names. And impressed me as much, impressed me so much that I'm still here. For that particular reason, I think for that particular reason, but the reason is actually Yahweh bringing you in this class. We all have a destiny in life. Whatever happened is not coincidence.
Right.
Happened for a reason.
Yep.
So to have a new guest in our class is from Mexico also, so is Ari. And I want to go into the names, that way I can open his understanding. We have in this chart
three names, Yahweh, Elohim, and Yahshua. Yahweh, as we know, is the true and correct name of the Creator. God, Lord, and Jesus Christ, those are new names. Are not names more than 1,000 years. Matter of fact, the name of Jesus Christ, as we've been taught, who was the name of the Father, Lord, I don't see no similarity. Jesus Christ, we Lord. If the Son came in His Father's name, should be something else, not Lord. Also, the letter J never was in the Hebrew alphabet, and there is not a J in the Hebrew alphabet till this day. The letter J was found the 13th century and appeared in the English alphabet the 17th century. That means Jesus, this name was only a little bit more than 300 years old. Only 300 years old, and a big part of the people in the world believe that this name Jesus came from a deity, Zeus, a Greek idol. Zeus, and Christ came from another god from India, Krishna. Now, if the Son came in His Father's name, when we say Yahweh is the Father's name, I don't see no similarity of Jesus Christ and Yahweh. But if we say Yahshua is the correct name of the one the world called Jesus Christ, this is the correct name, because this name came in His Father's name. The Yahweh is masculine and feminine. Yahweh. This is English, but the Hebrew writing and the Hebrew used to write the name of the Creator this way. YHWH. They call that tetragrammaton, four consonants. But that's impossible to pronounce without a vowels. But if we put the, well, this name, the Hebrew used to write the name from right to left. So this is an away from left to right. But if we insert the A right here, and we insert the E right here, we have Yahweh. The A, Yahweh. Yahweh is masculine and feminine. Now, if the Son came in His Father's name, and the masculine portion of Yahweh is Yah, He came in His Father's name, Yah. And His name of the Son means Yahweh the Savior. Shua in Hebrew means Savior. So Yahshua means Yahweh the Savior. Now we can prove the Son came in his Father's name. Yah is the abbreviation of Yahweh. Now, having the correct names, there is, like I said before, four letters in Hebrew that translate, if we translate those four letters of Hebrew in our language, this is in any language speaking in the world. Not only English. The A of Adam and the E of Eve. This way is called tetragrammaton. If you check in a good dictionary or encyclopedia, you find this tetragrammaton is the way they used to write the name of the kingdom. As simple as that. But what happened? People forgot those names. Because when they pronounced those names in vain, something happened to them. They were afraid to use those names. So little by little, they start not using those names. But this is the correct name of our Heavenly Father. Now, Elohim is the only divine title of Yahweh in a shape and form, not physical. Yahweh is invisible, incomprehensible, and indiscernible. The only way to be understood had to be shown himself in a way. And the way he chose to show his son is only in a visions, in a revelations. That's the only way he showed himself to some people, like he did to Moses. Moses, we all read and heard about Moses. But Moses, he was the first man in the whole history of the world knew for the first time the name of the Father, the name of the Son, and the name of the Holy Spirit. Not even the angels knew the name.
That's right.
Not even the angels. What revealed to him those names? Let's talk about Moses. Moses was a good, I can say good boy. Yahweh chose him for a purpose. We all have a purpose in life.
That's right, yeah.
All, without exception. But the purpose he had was something very important. Like I say, he was the first man heard about the name of Yahweh Elohim in Yahshua. He was a little boy, let me go back again. And in that time, the Hebrews, they were afraid. The Egyptians, they were afraid of the Hebrews, because the Hebrews started multiplying big time. In the beginning, They only were 70 souls went to Egypt. But they multiplied so, like I say, big time, and the king of the pharaoh of that land, Egypt, he was afraid of them. He said, if those people start multiplying, pretty soon they might overpower us. Let's put them to work. And he said, the men kill them. And the women, yes, let them live. So they start killing the little boys from 1 day to 3 months old. But Moses' mother, he was hiding the little boy, but he was growing. He was getting big. He don't have to wait to, there is no way to hide him for so long. So he made a basket, and he threw him in the Nile River, and told his daughter, follow the basket to see what happened to my son. So she went for the side of the river, watching the basket, and the basket went exactly where the daughter of Pharaoh was taking a bath with the other girls, the men. And she didn't cry over a little boy and tell one of the men, go and bring me the basket. They bring the basket, and she opened the basket and seen the little boy. Since she cannot have a baby, she adopted him as her son. But immediately after that happened, she knew the little boy was not Egyptian.
Right.
Was a Hebrew. Why, this is one of the mysteries, why she knew he was a Hebrew? For the particular reason of the Hebrews was the only race circumcised the babies. Since Abraham time, he was told by Yahweh to circumcise all the Hebrews. That was the difference from Hebrews from Gentiles. Gentiles means people are not Hebrew. So she adopted the baby, put her in the best school, educate, feed him, and treat him very good. But before that, when the little girl, Moses' sister, see the princess got the boy Moses, she right away went too close to the Pharaoh's door and said, oh, a little baby, I know who can feed the little boy. I know a lady just have a baby. She have some milk to feed him. Oh, good. So take the baby to the lady, and I pay for it. And when he grew up and don't need to be milk, bring back to me. That happened. So Moses, he grew up as a princess in Pharaoh's house. He had everything in him. And since he knew who he was, one day he was walking, seeing all the construction, all the work that he was building cities and temples and houses. But he seen a human, an Egyptian, being an Hebrew. And he didn't like that. He said, oh, he's being someone from my people. So he got so angry and killed the Egyptian. He was proved that way. He might mean to kill it or not, but he did it anyway. Had to be that way. Why? Like I say, nothing is coincidence. Everything is for a purpose and reason.
That's right.
He had to get up from there.
You have to escape and go away for a long time. Otherwise, they kill him. Because the next day, when he killed very the Egyptian, he went the next day, oh, nothing happened. Like nothing happened. Suddenly, two of his brothers were fighting, two Hebrews. And he went to say, you brothers, don't fight. Who are you to try to make peace with us? Or are you going to kill us as you did the Egyptian yesterday? When he find out, they see him and they discover, they knew he killed someone, he flew and escaped in a far away land. And he stayed there for 40 years, attending or live as a shepherd, declaring Jethro, his father-in-law, because he married one of his daughter, Zipporah.
That's right.
He was there working, you know, every day, work, but when one day he was with a, we have a picture over here. He was taking the lambs and the goats, and see a bush burning and not consumed. And he said, well, the bush is consumed so fast, and it's like keep going on. I better see what's happening there, or why it's keep burning. And he tried to go around and see, he said, hey, Moses, he called the bush. He hear his name from the bush. He said, Moses, stay there. Take the sandals of your feet, because the ground you're standing on is holy ground. So he was stunned. And I have a job for you from the middle of the bush, you see. I want you to go to Egypt, where you, all the people or your brothers live as a slave, and bring them out of there. I heard the crying, I know how they suffering a lot. But who are you to do the job? I don't qualify to do the job. First of all, I am not a good speaker. I get trouble. Moses, who makes men mouths, and Yahweh for showing him he had power again to convince him, he said, Moses, throw the rod you have in your hand to the floor, to the ground, because he was a shepherd. You can see it right here in the picture. He got a shepherd rod. So he just throw the rod, and the rod convert into a serpent. Pick up the rod, the serpent from the tail. So he bended and got it from the tail and became a rod again. So he said, oh, his power in the He didn't say that, but I presume in his mind, he said, ooh. Now, he said, put the head in your bosom and bring him out. He did so, and when the hand came out white, and as a leper, leprosy, mm-hmm. White. It was a disease, more dangerous disease in that time. Put the hand back to the bosom. He did so, and he bring the hand out, it was healed. Now, he knew. Well, listen, if someone asks me, who sent me? Who I tell them
the name, what name I can tell them. And again, Aya, Ashel, Aya. Those three words. And those three words we have over here. Aya, Ashel, Aya. This is the meaning of those three words. I will be what I want to be. In other words, I can be anything I want to. Aya, Ashel, Aya. But my name is Yahweh, and all the nations of the world should know my name. And if Yahweh revealed him, not only the name of Yahweh, Elohim, in Yahshua, in that time. With those, knowing those three names, but don't be afraid. Your brother will meet you and have way, and you wait. When you're going down there, he will meet you in the way. He will be your mouth spoken. He's going to talk to Pharaoh in your place, that you tell him what to tell him. So he went. And he went and said, Pharaoh, let my people go to worship our Elohim. 3 days. Why? Who is that God you have? He told me to tell you this. No. Go away. I don't listen to you. And he said, well, Pharaoh don't want to let our people go. Go and touch the waters of the Nile River and will be converted into blood. And he did so. For 3 days, all the waters of the kingdom was blood. Nobody can drink water. Not even the Hebrews can drink water. And he said, bring Moses. Oh, stop this thing, please. I will think about delivering you people, but just let the water become as it was. That way we can drink water. And our animals can drink water. So, Pharaoh changed his mind. He didn't fulfill his word. He said he wanna let the people go and worship the Elohim. And that happened for at least 9 times. When he changed his mind, was a 9 plagues, like I can say, fleas, frogs, fire coming from the sky, a lot of calamities. And Pharaoh changed his mind all the time. But the last time, he said, don't worry, Moses. Tell your people to go and sacrifice a lamb in every house, and with the blood of the lamb, put the paint the top of the door and the post in the sides, and put a little container underneath. And the lamb had to be consumed. If you have more than your family is too small, give to your neighbor the rest, and if it is still more, just burn it. And but not leave nothing. And Pharaoh All the Egyptians, they didn't paint the doors from the inside, not outside, like the movies they made. So that night, the firstborn of every family died because the angel came, and the firstborn of animals and people too, including Pharaoh's son, he died. Pharaoh's son was hard because Yahweh made the heart of Pharaoh's heart for a purpose. Because everything, if Moses went over and said, "Hey Moses, let my people go," and something like the Nile River turned to blood, and it's okay, I let them go. Even the Hebrews did not appreciate. It was so easy. And since it was hard for them to go away, and what happened, the firstborn of everything, every animal died, and the people too. The Pharaoh's heart became soft. He said, "Okay, go away." They pack and take all the good substance. Take silver, gold, jewels, cloth, the best there is in Egypt. Take it, because we need those things. So they run with all those things to far land. They just want to go away from Egypt. The Pharaoh's heart changed into a heart again. And he told his son, "Hey, go on. Get those people and kill them." I don't know why they say to let them free, no. Go and get them. So they went, the Hebrews, they went so close to the Red Sea, and they told him, "Oh, the Egyptians coming over with the chariots. And we have the ocean here. Moses, why you bring us to die over here? We were better in Egypt. In Egypt, at least we have to work and eat and clothes, and but we don't have to die. Don't worry." But that time, Moses had a minister, Hoshea, the son of Nun, and he instructed Moses to put the rod up, and the Red Sea opened as a tunnel, and all the Hebrews escaped from them till the last one. But the reason why the Hebrews didn't go and get them, because it was as twisted during the day, and then during the night was a twisted of fire too, so they cannot go and slay the Hebrews. But when every Hebrew cross the Red Sea, the twisted go in front of them, and the Hebrews, the Egyptians say, "Oh, now is our time. Now we can do and kill them." So they run, and they, when they were in the middle of the ocean, the Red Sea, the waters covered them and killed them. So they went to the other side, the Hebrews, and they were in the mountain. Yeshua, or Chia, told Moses to tell the people to clean for 3 days, and don't have no women, and don't get so close to the mountain. Whoever touches the mountain, be dead. Even an animal can die being too close and touching him. When Moses went up there, he received a verbal law, and he came down
But when he speak, when Yahweh told the Lord to Moses and come over to the Hebrews, he said, please, we don't want El Shaddai to speak to us, because the ground and everything, our ears, is so strong. Whatever he wants us to do, or we do it, but you tell us, we don't want he speak to us. So that was the first time Moses went up. He went three times. The second time, he went up in the mountain, and he received also the law written in a stone, like you want to see, you see over here. And when he came down, he could stay there 40 days in the mountain. And when he was there 40 days, he was put to sleep, because he see a panoramic vision.
That's right.
He see how the 6 day of the creation, mm-hmm, plus the 7, the one Yahweh rest, 7 total. He see how the waters, the light was divided from the darkness, the waters above and the waters below, the earth separated from the ground, the 4th day the fish and the animals, or the 3rd day the vegetation too came out, the 4th day the sun, the stars and the planets and the universe, the moon, and the 5th day all the animals, birds and fish and cattle or animals on the ground. But the 6th day, Moses see how Yahweh made Adam of the men and the likeness and image of Elohim. There is more, but I'm going to give next speaker to keep going in this explanation. Okay, thank you very much, and I hope I did something anybody you.
Our next speaker will be Dr. Bo Williams. Christians, and you know, a lot of times you see people, they don't even have the whole Bible, they just got the New Testament.
Testament of Heart, the Book of Psalms, and again, I'm tucked under their arm, and I'm a New Testament Christian, and you try to tell somebody about something in the Old Testament, you know, they say, oh, well, that's, you know, and with the exception of the laws that they'll do, you know, like people will draw out tithing from the Old Testament, they'll bring that up, mm-hmm. All right, you know, did you tithe, you know, you robbing God, you know, household and tithes, exactly, you know, that kind of thing, you're quoting scripture, you know, like that. See, they'll use the Old Testament when it's, you know, expedient or, you know, advantageous, you know, otherwise, you know, it's like a smorgasbord to a lot of Christians. They pick and choose what they want, what's convenient, what's expedient, what's profitable, that kind of thing. But what I want to do, John 4:24. Let's try that first.
John 4:24.
Mm-hmm.
For Elohim, for Yahweh is spirit,
mm-hmm.
and they that worship him must worship him in spirit and in truth.
Now it says, now Yahweh is spirit. Now, in the Bible, in the King James Bible, it'll say God is a spirit, and I think in the Holy Name, it'll say Elohim the spirit. But the more correct pronunciation is, okay.
Right here. On the podium.
Oh, okay, I see it. Oh, thank you. Okay. Now this is what it says in the Bible. It'll say God is a spirit or Elohim is a spirit. It'll have this article, A. Okay? Now what I found in Thomas was simply this. Get rid of the A out of the kingdom. Kick the A right out of that sentence. Because Yahweh is spirit as opposed to is a spirit. Because when you say he is a spirit, then you denote that, oh, he's one kind of spirit, and then there's another kind of spirit in existence. Whereas he's simply telling you that Yahweh is spirit, and that's all that there is. Even the scriptures will tell you that I am Yahweh, there is none else. Okay? Now, if he's spirit, okay, see, if he's spirit, as opposed to being a spirit, see, the spirit is the source, we say it's the source and substance of all things, okay? Because he is spirit, as opposed to is a spirit. See, as I said, if you say he is a spirit, then that means there's one kind of spirit in existence, and there's another kind. But we're saying is he is spirit, meaning that that's all that there is. When you look around you, the sun, moon, stars, etc., matter is spirit materialized. See, that simply means that this, we identify spirit as these attributes here. Wisdom, intelligence, knowledge, love, beauty, justice, foundation, power, strength. It's not all of the attributes, but these are the main primary attributes from which others are drawn out of. It would be very similar to like the elements. We have a periodic table of elements. Like if you take different elements and put them together, they form compounds. Like sodium, for example, is one element, and you got chloride, that's another element. But if you put sodium and chloride together, it forms a compound, and it becomes salt. See, that's the combination of it. Same way with these attributes. See, you form these attributes together, they form other attributes. See, if I were to take love and justice, the attribute of love and justice, and put it together, the resulting combination or offspring would be mercy. See, the combination of love and justice. See, because if there's true justice and you look at a situation, like for example, like somebody may kill someone, for example, but it depends on the circumstances. Maybe it could have been a situation where you were in your home and someone broke into your home at night and you didn't know and you had to shoot him. Now the court will look at that. They'll bring you to court and all that. They'll look at the evidence and they say, okay, well, you were defending yourself. The guy broke into your home. You didn't know who he was. He was burglar. like you don't know what is there, but Eva's there, your wife's there, your kid's there, you don't know what's going on, so you defend your home. And so the court will look at that and say, okay, well, look, well, that's justifiable homicide. See, they considered, they looked at the justice of, you know, and took in consideration love, and looked at that and put it together and said, okay, well, look, you know, murder is a bad thing, killing another human being is a bad thing, but we understand why you did it. So therefore, we will give you mercy for this. Because it was justifiable, because you were in danger, your family was in danger, some guy broke into your, you know, that kind of thing. That's how they look at that. Okay, so I'm just using that as an example to show that these attributes form other attributes. That's the point I'm making. These attributes, and this is pure spirit, John 1 and 1. Pure spirit, we can't understand that. That's an abstract statement. Okay, it's inconceivable. Therefore, it behooves Yahweh to move into a state that he could be perceived. See, now the first thing you talked about these names, see, but when you talk about the names, you have to talk about states and conditions. Yahweh, see, as we said, see, is pure spirit. That is the Father. See, he is all in all in all. Or as you would say in Latin, terminus ad quem. You know, say the limits and the bounds. Okay? Now, what John 1 and 1?
John 1 and 1. In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with Yahweh, mm-hmm. and the Word was Yahweh.
Now it says, in the beginning was the Word, and the Word was Yahweh. You gotta tilt that down just a little bit. Thank you. Now, I have been taught, because I grew up in a Baptist church, that this was the Word of God. Just talking about this Bible. Alright? That's what I was taught. Now, this Bible and what we just read, the Word, is not the same thing.
Right.
These are words, plural, but this is not the Word for the simple reason that this book was not in the beginning of creation.
Right.
See, this book does not have lips on it. Because when he talks about the Word, and it will go back into the Old Testament, it'll say certain scriptures like, and the Word of Yahweh came unto me and said thus. Oh, wait a minute. This Word can talk. This Bible does not have lips on it.
Right.
Okay? So obviously this is not what they were talking to or what was talking to them. You see what I'm saying? Now it says in the beginning was the Word. Let's find out what this Word is. Proverbs 8:20. I think it's 8:20, right?
Mm-hmm. Proverbs 8:20. I led in the way.
22 then.
Oh, okay. Yahweh possessed me in the beginning of his way.
Now, the man who wrote this book, this is the book of Proverbs, he was King Solomon. And he's pretty famous, son of David. Known primarily for his wisdom. All right? But Solomon is not writing of himself. When he says Yahweh possessed me, the me that he's talking about is not himself. Because this is the me. He said, Yahweh possessed me in the beginning. Well, in the beginning of what, read?
Before his works of old.
In the beginning, start that again. Beginning
Yahweh possessed me in the beginning of his ways.
In the beginning of his ways, read.
Before his works of old.
Before his works of old. So Yahweh possessed me in the beginning of his ways. Before his works of old, or before he created a universe. Yahweh possessed me. Now that's the me we want to get to find out here, okay? Read.
I was set up from everlasting, from the beginning or ever the earth was.
Okay, now this is what he's showing, that this me was set up before anything come about. Now Yahweh, pure spirit, cannot be understood by anybody or anyone or anything. Therefore, it behooved him to transmute into a state that he could be perceived. The first speaker talked about it, the Word or the Son. This is known as Elohim. Now, Elohim is a divine title. It's a plural title. This is a plural title. It's plural. It's two or more. The single tense of Elohim is Eloah. That's single tense. Okay? But this is plural. And see, there's a reason why it's plural. Because the first speaker went through it when he talked about the name. Yahweh, Adam and Eve, male and female. Elohim or Elohim, it's the same way. Because he transmuted in part into a state that we call, is a nice word, we say we're a school. Anthropomorphic, I'll use the better word, I'll say anthropomorphism. Elohim. This is an anthropomorphic state. See? When we say anthropomorphic, what we're really saying is that he's in the shape and form of a man. Okay? Mm-hmm. All right. Are we at the back? Mm-hmm. All right. Anthro. The word anthro means man. Morph. Means to shape. It means to form. So when we say anthropomorphism or anthropomorphic, we're just simply saying in the shape, and form of a man. So we say, when we talk about Elohim, or more, which is a title, because his name is Yahweh Elohim, we call this the great heavenly anthropomorphic being. Because from this, let's keep reading in Proverbs.
When there was no depth, I was brought forth.
This is him being brought forth. This is the word being brought forth. This you can't see. You can't perceive that. Yahweh know that. Right. So he had to come into a state that you could perceive him.
Right.
And this can be perceived in visions and revelation. This is what the prophet saw. The shape and form of a man. A heavenly man, a great anthropomorphic man.
Mm-hmm.
See, continue.
When there was no fountain abounding with water, before the mountains were settled, before the hills was I brought forth.
Uh-huh.
While as yet he had not made the earth, nor the fields, nor the highest part of the dust of the world. When he prepared the heaven, I was there when he set a compass upon the face of the deep.
Mm-hmm.
When he established the cloud above, when he strengthened the fountain of the deep. When he gave to the sea his decree that the waters should not pass his commandment. When he appointed the fountain of the earth. Then I was by him as one brought up with him. And I was daily his delight, rejoicing always before him. Rejoicing in the habitable parts of his earth, and my delight were with the sons of men.
All right, now go back to John. That's who that is. That's who that is. Okay? See, I go back to John.
Wait.
Yes.
In the beginning was the Word.
Now we know what this Word was, because in the beginning was this Word, because we just read it was before anything that was created. Read.
And the Word was with Yahweh.
Now this Word was with Yahweh. Read.
And the Word was Yahweh.
This Word was Yahweh. It still is Yahweh. Read.
The same was in the beginning with Yahweh. All things were made by Him.
Mm-hmm.
And without Him was not anything made that was made.
Uh-huh.
In Him was life, and the life was the light of men.
This is the light of men, because this is what animates everything. See, whether you realize it or not, and it's going to tell you, read.
And the light shineth in darkness, and the darkness comprehended it not.
Now, this light shineth out of darkness, that is to say, out of the ignorance of the world. But the ignorance of the world, you don't comprehend that. That's why we have this school here. So you can learn to comprehend that light that is within you.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, now this is Yahweh Elohim. This is the Word. Mm-hmm. Alright? Now jump down to the 14th verse.
And the Word was made flesh.
Now this Word was made flesh. and it says right here, the same word, now listen carefully, that we just read that created everything, that was before everything, now this word is made flesh.
Right.
Come on.
And dwelt among us, and we beheld his glory, the glory of the only begotten of the Father, full of grace and truth.
Now, that's who this was. And see, and look, we all have a first time when we came in here, okay? And you come in, you see these charts, you know, and stuff, and you think at first, you know, like, wow, am I in an art gallery or what, you know? But I would think in most cases, when people look at the charts, I mean, if you look at them carefully and you know something about the Bible, you recognize some figures. But more than likely, out of all the charts in here, that people would recognize just right off the bat, look at this one, because
right.
This is an iconic image here.
Right.
Jesus on the cross.
Yeah.
I mean, you could put this image on a stick and walk around, and people would know what it is or what it represents.
Right.
Okay, everybody knows this. Mm-hmm. The problem is everybody don't know who this is. Because everybody's got an opinion. Well, let's see. This is Joseph. Some folks say people of his day say, well, this is Joseph and Mary's boy. Some people say, well, okay, if God is his father and Mary's his mother, then he's half divine and half human. And people have come up with a lot of different things, you know. I mean, the Illuminati, you know, they say, well, we are the descendants of him and Mary Magdalene who got married and they had kids. That's what they said. So everybody's got their own opinion on it. There's some people that are saying, you know, this guy, well, he didn't get married, you know, we didn't see him around no women. Maybe he was gay. But people say that. I remember years ago somebody wrote a book. It was called The Passover Plot. And they postulated that, you know, Judas Iscariot was a secret zealot, and they tried to get him involved in the zealot cause, the zealots, which were the Palestinian terrorists of their day, all right, against the Romans, all right. But what we're showing you is this is Yahweh, I mean, this is the Creator himself. This is not his little boy. This is the Creator himself. See, because John 5:7. Because, see, the thing that people, or Christianity has always tried to show is that, well, you got three personalities going. You got God the Father, God the Son, and God the Holy Spirit. And I remember, I grew up a Baptist. And of course, you know, in the Baptist tradition, one of the big things they do is they dunk you in water. All right? And I was 8 years old when I got baptized. And me and three other guys, same ages. And they had us up there, fully clothed, and, you know, in a suit and ties. And up in the pool pit, too. They pulled us right into the pit because there was a pool. There was a converted pool. You had to take the chairs off and fill it up with water. And you had stairs. You would go down to the pool pit. And so I remember they had me down in there. I was, you know, water was up to here. And they was praying over me and all. And then I remember they said, you know, I baptize you in the name of the Father. You know, and I remember, even at the time, as an 8 year old, I had enough presence of mind to think, like, okay, the name of the Father. And I'm thinking, you know, God. And in the name of the Son, Jesus. And in the name of the Holy Ghost.
Yeah.
I'm like, okay, what's up with that? You know, I think I even asked the preacher that, you know, and he didn't say, well, it's the Holy Ghost and some power and that kind of thing. Yeah. Anyway, 1 John.
1 John 5:7. For there are three that bear record in heaven, the Father,
mm-hmm.
the Word, and the Holy Spirit. And these three are one.
Now, the Father, the Word, and the Holy Spirit, these three are one. See, now, that does not mean three individuals or three distinct personalities. What we're trying to show you is this. Matter is spirit materialized. And we showed you that there's pure spirit, state of Yahweh. Pure spirit, imperceivable, imperceptible, right? Can't see it, can't perceive it, nothing. So it behooved him to transmute in part into this shape and form, see, which is known as Elohim, or the Word. Then this Word was made flesh and dwelt among us. So what you have is two manifestations of the one spirit. You have Yahweh, pure spirit, Yahweh in shape and form, incorporeal, or a great heavenly anthropomorphic being, the Word, and then you have the Word made flesh, Yahshua. But it's still Yahweh. It's two manifestations of one Spirit. See, let me look into that. Keep reading quickly.
8, and there are three that bear witness in earth, the Spirit, and the water,
and
the blood, and these three agree in one.
Now these three agree in one. In other words, these are the three witnesses that prove that there is a creator in existence. In other words, we'll show you.
If we receive the witness of men, the witness of Yahweh is greater, for this is the witness of Yahweh which he hath testified of his Son. He that believeth on the Son of Yahweh hath the witness in himself.
Now see, now you have the witness in yourself. Because everybody has blood. I mean, if you're walking around alive, that is. You have blood running warm in your veins. You have water. And you have the Spirit operating. See, your existence is proof of his existence. Because people will say, you know, I'm an agnostic, because an agnostic is somebody who believes in a creator, but thinks there's no proof. An atheist is someone who says, well, there is no creator, and so therefore, you know, he denies the existence of one, no matter what. But the proof is you are the existence. See, even the scientists know that it takes some grand intelligence to create this universe. What they don't believe is the religious dogma of all these different religious institutions. They don't subscribe to that. But a true scientist knows that this universe didn't just come about happenstance, you know, a helter-skelter. That there's some sort, that there's an order, there's a logic to it. They just don't understand what it is. See, what we're trying to show you that there is a logic to it, see. There is an order. And see, that order is this tabernacle pattern. Now, in the New Testament, Paul talks about it, see, which will lead you back to the Old Testament, Hebrews 8 and 5. I'm trying to hit a lot of those points so that I can get back to where Samuel's at. Go ahead.
Hebrews 8 and 5. Who serve unto the example and shadow of heavenly things, as Moses was admonished of Elohim, when he was about to make the tabernacle. For see, said he, that thou make all things according to the pattern shown to thee in the mountain.
Now see, now a lot of New Testament Christians would read that and they wouldn't know what that meant, or what that's about, or why even Paul's even mentioning that. See, but if you understood a lot of things that the Apostle Paul was writing and saying, a lot of it is drawn from the Old Testament. See, and if you had a good enough Bible, like our Bible, the Holy Name Bible, it's not our Bible, mind you. We didn't publish it. But in there, it does have references in the so-called New Testament, the scriptures that are being quoted from the Old. And if you have a real good Bible like I got, like a Scofield, it will tell you exactly where those scriptures are at in the Old Testament that Paul is referencing and quoting from. So now for this pattern, he's quoting something from the Old Testament. Something that Moses talked about. Now people say, well, so what? What's so important about talking about Moses? Well, because he talked about Moses. He referred to Moses. See, John 3:13, quickly, I need some speed here because I need to hit these points real fast. Matthew 3:13, forgive me.
Matthew 3:13. Then cometh Joshua from Galilee to Jordan unto John to be baptized of him. But John forbade him, saying, I have need to be baptized of thee, and comest thou to me? And Joshua answering, saying unto him, permit it to be so now, for thus it becometh us to fulfill all righteousness.
Now that's what he said. He said, thus it becometh us to fulfill all righteousness. Now for John to baptize him, see, you have to confess to John. You have to confess that he was unable to keep this law of Moses, the 613 ordinances, see, that was given to them at Mount Sinai. You have to confess that publicly, right? And then he would do that. But when Yahshua comes along, he hadn't sinned or transgressed this law. And so John is like, well, you need to baptize me. I said, no, there's a purpose in this. The Thus it becometh us to fulfill all righteousness. Fulfill our righteousness is a phrase that still stumbles Christianity. One, the word fulfill means to complete, to bring to an end, as of a promise. And righteousness, well, the only righteousness a person could have at that time even was if they could perform 613 of these ordinances, which they could not, because if you broke one, you was guilty of the whole thing. See? Right? And besides, unless you were a Jew, it wouldn't give it to you in the first place. Okay? But now, Matthew 5:17,
let me just run
here.
Think not that I am come to destroy the law or the prophets.
Uh-huh.
I am not come to destroy, but to fulfill.
Now there he goes again. See, now he's on top of a mountain, talking to a multitude, and he's saying the same thing. Look, I come to fulfill this law, not institute. See, that's what people have said. Is that people say, no, I got to follow Jesus' example. He got baptized, I got to get baptized. His out of his own mouth says, no, I am here to fulfill. The word fulfill means to complete. But the way he had to complete it, he had to perform it.
Right.
When he performed it, that was the end of it. And that was him doing it for you so that you wouldn't have to. So it would be done in the spirit. We'll get to that later as we'll explain quickly.
For verily I say unto you, till heaven and earth pass, one yard of the smallest part of the letter shall in no wise pass from the law till all be fulfilled.
Till all be fulfilled. That's what he's doing. He's fulfilling. Everything he's doing for 33 and a half years is a fulfillment or a performing and a concluding of 4,000 years of people, places, and things. Everything he's doing in his life is a fulfillment of something that's written in the Old Testament. Why was he born in Bethlehem? Because David the king was born in Bethlehem. Why was he born in a stable full of animals? Because the man Adam, as it was pointed out, when he was created, he was placed in the midst of the animals. Everything, you understand what I'm saying? Everything he's doing is a fulfillment of something that's in the Old Testament. He had to do that because why? That's how they would know he was the true Messiah. Because many false ones had come. But the true Messiah would be the one that could perform that which what Moses and the prophets wrote. That's how they would know. I want to go with this. John 5:36.
But I have greater witness than that of John.
Now, I got a greater witness than that of John. Remember, we saw John, he's out there, he was a spectacle. I mean, this was a man that had a camel hair suit, all right? And you had a pouch full of, you know, dried locusts and wild, you know, honeycomb, you know, long beard. I mean, he was like, out in the middle of the, and look, we got to tell you, we just got him and Yahweh, but let me tell you something. There was a multitude of people out there. Because they knew he was a prophet. And them people came by the throngs, okay? And they were baptizing left and right, the people. Why? Because it was brought out. The Israelites, they went to the divided waters of the Red Sea, and they got baptized.
Right.
See? That's why we have this illustration here. See, we have John the Baptist baptizing Yahshua along the line because it's a fulfillment of the Israelites being baptized in the cloud and in the sea back here. Everything is a fulfillment of what he's doing. Everything in the Old Testament. Quickly.
Continue with John.
Well, you're reading.
I have greater witness of that of John, for the works which the Father hath given me to finish, the same works that I do bear witness of me that the Father has sent me.
Now see, now the works that I do, what was he doing? He got baptized, he got circumcised, he did ceremony, he did Passovers, sacrifices, the Ten Commandments, law, tithing, this, that. He did those things to perform them, to bring them to an end. And these things would show that they pointed to him. See? Read.
And the Father himself, which hath sent me, hath borne witness of me.
Mm-hmm.
You have neither heard his voice at any time, nor seen his shape. And you have not his word abiding in you. For whom he hath sent him, you believe not.
Mm-hmm.
You search the scriptures, for in them you think you have eternal life, and they are they that testify of me.
Now he said, now this is Jesus Christ talking here, folks. The Messiah, Yahshua Messiah. This is him talking. He said, look, you search the scriptures. Now, the scriptures that they had at that time, there was no Old Testament. There was no Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John. There was no epistles of Paul or Peter. There was no book of Revelation. When he said, you search the scriptures. When he said, you search the scriptures, at the time when he was walking around and he said that, the only scriptures they had is what we call the Old Testament. The books from Genesis to Malachi, what the Jews called the Torah, the first five books of the Bible. Genesis, Exodus, Leviticus, Numbers, Deuteronomy. Those were the scriptures he said, go search. The books of the prophecy from Joshua to Malachi. Those were the books he said, you go search. Read that again.
You search the scriptures.
Now you go back in the Old Testament and you search them, read.
For in them you think you have eternal life.
You think you got eternal life because you read in there about these ordinances and you think, he's talking about them scribes and Pharisees. And you know, they were all pompous and whatnot, arguing this and you know, throwing out, you know. And so you think it's talking about you. But what?
And they are they which testify of me.
They are they that testify of me. So in other words, when I go back in the Old Testament and I read something about Adam, I'm not reading anything about Adam.
Right.
I'm reading about him.
That's right.
When I go back and read the story of Noah and his family, I'm not reading about Noah. Mm-hmm. I'm reading about him. When I go back and read about Abraham and Melchizedek and all that, I'm not reading about them. I'm reading about him. Do you understand that? They all pointed to him. Everything, because the book is low. I don't know where it's at. It's in Psalms. It's low. I come in the volume of the book. It's written of me to do thy will, O Yahweh. That's what you have to understand. Is there anything else there?
You will not come to me that you might have life.
Uh-huh.
I receive not honor from men,
mm-hmm.
but I know you, and you have not the love of Yahweh in you.
Mm-hmm.
I am come in my Father's name.
Whoa. Did we just talked about the Father's name? He said, I come in my Father's name. But what is my Father's name? Mm-hmm. Is it Lord? Is it God? But if so, then my name is Lord Junior, God Junior. The first people talked about Krishna. What was my Father's name? Krishna Senior? What is my name? What's my Father's name? If my Father's name is Yahweh, then my name has got to be Yah something.
Right.
If I come in my Father's name.
That's right.
That's what he said. Read.
I am come in my Father's name and you receive me not.
But you don't want to receive that. You don't want to hear. And that's even to this day. You try to tell that to people because people will fight you about a name. They say, oh, no, it don't matter about the name, but you try to take Jesus away from it and see what happens. See, I come in my Father's name, you don't want to accept me, but anybody else, you'll accept. Jesus, Buddha, Muhammad, Allah, Krishna, Zoroastra, you know, whoever. You, some people put themselves in there, you know. You accept anything else except who he is. Read.
If another shall come in his own name, him you will receive. How can you believe which receive honor one of another?
Mm-hmm.
And seek not the honor that cometh from Yahweh only.
Mm-hmm.
Do not think that I will accuse you to the Father. There is one that accuseth you, even Moses in whom you trust.
Even Moses in whom you trust. See.
For had you believed Moses, you would have believed me, for he wrote of him.
And you know, to this day, I can't find the name Jesus anywhere in the Old Testament. He said Moses wrote about it, but where is that at? I don't see it. I don't see Jesus nowhere.
Right.
If his name is really Jesus. Now, he said his name is Yahshua. Now, Yahshua I can find in the Old Testament. Moses did write about a Yahshua.
Mm-hmm.
That can be verified in any Bible. He wrote about a Yahshua, but I challenge anybody to show me somewhere in any version of the Bible where Moses wrote anything about Jesus. If you can show me that, we can shut this down. But you're not going to find it, simply because it does not exist. Luke 24. 26, 27, I think that's what I want.
25.
25, thank you.
24 and 25. Then he said unto them, O fools and slow of heart, to believe all that the prophets have spoken.
Now this is him on the road to Emmaus with the guys. This is after, mind you, his death, his burial, and his resurrection. So now, what he said during his life, he said he came to fulfill. This is what he said after his death, burial, and resurrection. Read.
Ought not the Messiah to have suffered these things and to enter into his glory?
Uh-huh.
And beginning at Moses and all the prophets, he expounded unto them in all the scriptures the things concerning himself.
In other words, Moses and the prophets, what do you mean? The Old Testament. He stood up there with these two guys, and because the only scriptures they had was the Old Testament, and he went into the Old Testament and showed them the things that's written in the Old Testament concerning himself. Okay? 44.
And he said unto them, these are the words which I spake unto you, mm-hmm, while I was yet with you,
mm-hmm,
that all things must be fulfilled, which were written in the law of Moses.
The first five books?
And in the prophets.
The rest of the books.
And in the Psalms.
Even the Psalms, in case you left that out. That's the Old Testament concerning me.
Right.
This is him talking. Okay? If this was a red letter edition of the Bible, that's in red, it would be in red letters because this is him talking. Okay? So now this is the reason why we go back to Moses. Why we go back to the Old Testament, see? And the first speaker brought out, he laid the heart and showed the story of how Yahweh introduced himself to Moses back here at the burning bush. Or how through Moses, he was sent down to Egypt. 10 devastating plagues was poured upon Pharaoh. The Israelites, they came out through the miraculously divided waters of the Red Sea. And they found themselves encamped around this mount because they followed a phenomenal cloud. There was a cloud by day and a pillar of fire by night. And the same cloud set on top of this mountain and spoke to the Israelites, thundered down into their consciousness the Ten Commandments of Law. And then later put them on tables of stone, which Moses came down and with the first set, and he broke them because the Israelites built this golden calf. But then he's going back, we'll get to that later, but right now I'm going to go back to where the first people left off, because he had Moses up here. Let's get, that boy, okay. All right, Exodus 24:1, quickly.
Exodus 24:1. And he said unto Moses, come up unto Yahweh, thou and Aaron, Nadab and Abihu, and 70 of the elders of Israel, and worship you afar off.
Okay, now he told Moses to come up alone and by himself, and we have it illustrated up here. There's Aaron, Nadab and Abihu, and these 70 elders, and Moses told him to come up alone and by himself. Alright, now let's jump down to 9:10.
9. Then went up Moses and Aaron, Nadab and Abihu, and 70 of the elders of Israel. And they saw the Elohim of Israel, and it was under his feet as it were.
Stop for a minute. Let's do this right quick. Put your finger there and get... You put your finger there. They want to get John 1:18 in the King James Version. Quickly. Somebody.
Okay, I got to get this. John 1:18. No man has seen the Father. No man has seen the Father in any
case. Is that the King James Version?
No man has seen God.
Thank you.
The only begotten Son, which is in the bosom of the Father, he hath declared.
Now he says, no man has seen God at any time. Now go back to where we read in Exodus and read the King James Version from that.
And they saw the God of Israel.
Now wait a minute. Now which is it? Because see, one said, no man has seen God at any time. Now we got a verse that says, they saw the God of Israel. You see how important it is when you have the names. See, that's Lord God Jesus Christ said they wrote his names. Because see, one just said, no man has seen God at any time. The other one said, they saw God. And the first thing somebody said, well, see, look, the Bible contradicts itself. See? But now, what she had read earlier, correctly first, she said in John 1:18, no man has seen the Father, which is Yahweh in pure spirit. No man has seen the Father at any time. But Elohim, he's seen in visions and revelations. Now go back to Exodus and read it correctly.
And they saw the Elohim of Israel.
Now they saw the Elohim of the God of Israel. They saw the Elohim of Israel, read.
And there was under his feet as it were.
Now they described it because he said he had feet. Read.
A paved work of a sapphire stone.
Uh-huh.
And as it were, the body of heaven in his
clothes. And he had a body.
And upon the nobles of the children of Israel, he laid not his hand.
It is not him. So it's describing a man. Okay?
They saw Elohim and didn't eat and drink.
They saw Elohim and they didn't eat and drink. Read.
And Yahweh said unto Moses, Come up to me into the mount and be there. I will give thee tables of stone and the law and commandments which I have written that thou mayest teach them. And Moses ran up and his minister Joshua and Moses.
Wait, hold on. Read that again.
And Moses rode up, and his minister Joshua.
Wait, didn't we just read in the first verse that said that Moses was told to come up alone and by himself?
Mm-hmm.
Why is this guy going with you?
Mm-hmm.
Read.
And Moses went up into the Mount of Elohim, and he said unto the elders, Tarry you here for us.
I said, Tarry you here for us. I mean, that's not a scribal error there. He said, Tarry you here for us.
Right.
Me and so this Joshua character is going up with Moses, read.
Until we come again unto you.
Uh-huh.
And behold, Aaron and Hur are with you.
Mm-hmm.
If any man have any matters to do, let him come unto them.
Mm-hmm.
And Moses went up into the mount, and the cloud covered the mount. And the glory of Yahweh abode upon Mount Sinai, and the cloud covered it 6 days.
Now the cloud covered it 6 days, see, and read, keep reading.
And the seventh day, he called unto Moses on the midst of the cloud.
Okay, now look, here's the mystery that a lot of ministers don't understand. And they will tell you this. And look, we even got, I think we got a Bible over here. Do we got a Gideon's Bible over here somewhere?
Yeah,
we got a Gideon's Bible here. It will tell you, I'm pretty sure it will. Yep, it sure does. It will tell you right up here. At the top, it says Genesis, the first book of Moses called Genesis.
Mm-hmm.
All right? Now, so okay, that's good. 5 seconds is usually good enough. Now, the theologians know Moses wrote the book of Genesis. In fact, they know that Moses wrote the first 5 books of the Bible, Genesis, Exodus, Leviticus, Numbers, Deuteronomy. But we're going to focus on Genesis for a minute. Because the theologians, they know Moses wrote it, but they don't know how he wrote it or how he came about the information that's in the book of Genesis, considering that the events in the book of Genesis happened 2,513 years before this event right here that we're reading about. Okay? Now, for Moses to have written the book of Genesis, he would have had to receive a vision and a revelation. And we're going to show you quickly how that come about. Now read the scriptures, the verse you just read. Exodus 24, 16.
And the glory of Yahweh abode upon Mount Sinai. And the cloud covered it 6 days.
Now the cloud covered it 6 days. And this is what, she said colon, because usually there's a colon there. And whenever you have a colon or even a semicolon, usually there has to be an explanation that follows. But then the scripture that comes after that, read it.
In the beginning.
No. The scripture after that scripture.
In the seventh day he called unto Moses on the midst of the cloud.
Now, but that doesn't explain what happened for the previous 6 days. See, it just says that on the seventh day, Moses came out. Okay, so what happened on the six days? See, do you understand my point? There has to be an explanation, and it's not there right there. So now to find the explanation, we have to go and see what those 6 days are about. Now to find that out, we have to go to our scripture lesson, which was Genesis 1:1. See, because Moses up here 6 days, and so Moses is being shown the Genesis, reading.
In the beginning, Elohim created the heavens and the earth.
Now, in the beginning, Moses is writing this. Actually, what is happening is, Moses, after he comes out of the cloud, he's going to tell the 70 elders what happened, because he's going to be up there 40 days, and they're going to wonder, Moses, you was up here gone for 40 days. What happened to you up there? And he's standing there, and he's talking to himself, and he's just telling the story. And they're writing it down like stenographers. And he's saying, well, in the beginning, Elohim created the heavens and the earth. In the beginning of what? See, in the beginning of what? In the beginning of the vision. See, in the beginning of this vision, Elohim created the heavens and the earth. Well, the question you want to ask is, where did Elohim come from? Don't you remember? Moses even grew up here by himself.
Right.
He had this guy Joshua with him. And look, Joshua the Messiah said, Moses wrote of me.
Right.
Joshua, there's no J in the Hebrew alphabet, so it's really rendered Yahshua. Moses did write about Yahshua because he said so. Moses wrote of me. Well, how did Moses write about me? Because I was back there with Moses.
That's right.
Put your finger there and quickly get 1 Corinthians 10:1.
Moreover, brethren, I would not that you be ignorant, that all our fathers were under the cloud, all passed through the sea.
This is Paul writing about something that happened in the Old Testament, in the so-called New Testament. He's referring back to that. He said, remember how Moses come up out this, the cloud and all green.
And we're all baptized into Moses in the cloud and in the sea.
Read.
And did all eat the same spiritual meat.
Uh-huh.
And did all drink the same spiritual drink.
Mm-hmm.
For they drank of that spiritual rock that went with them.
Uh-huh.
And that rock was the Messiah.
And that rock was the Messiah. Paul is telling you that he was back there with Moses. The Messiah was back there with him. And we're showing you he's right here with Moses. He was the one that went up into the cloud with Moses. And he transfigured in front of Moses to show his body. And someone would say, well, gee, that's impossible. I don't believe that. Well, look here. Because when you read in the 16th chapter of Matthew, that's when Joshua did what he transfigured in front of his disciples. He did the same thing. Why did he do that here? Because he did it back here. He's fulfilling. See? So he had to turn and show that there's an Elohim. And then he transfigured. Look, now let's keep reading. I'll get to that, I hope.
But with many of them, Elohim...
No, the day, Genesis, Genesis.
And the earth became without form and void.
Uh-huh.
And darkness was upon the face of the deep.
Now here's the earth without form and void, sinking in and out of the water, and darkness on the face of the deep move.
And the spirit of Elohim moved upon the face of the waters.
Yes, this is dove, like representing the spirit of Elohim, moving across the face of the waters. All right?
And Elohim said, let there be light, and there was light. And Elohim saw the light, that it was good.
Uh-huh.
And Elohim divided between the light and between the darkness.
Mm-hmm.
And Elohim called the light day, and the darkness he called night.
Mm-hmm.
And the evening and the morning was the first day.
Now see, now this is accounting for the 6 days that Moses is up here in the vision. He's seeing the days of creations unfold during the 6 days that he's up here in the cloud. See, I can't go through all the days, but you get the idea. Each day, and you can see, and look, this is Elohim here. See, Elohim is transforming into each day of the creation for Moses. In other words, he is transmuting into every aspect of the creation. See, and he's showing Moses, see, in a vision, in the realm of eternity. In other words, this is so vast that it literally took Moses 6 solar days to see this whole thing. In other words, what she just read, it took a whole solar day for Moses to observe. See, because in the evening and the morning was the first day. In other words, Elohim got up, did his work, then he sat down. And then read.
And Elohim said, let there be a firmament in the midst of the waters, and let it separate the waters from the waters.
Uh-huh.
And Elohim made the firmament and divided the waters, which was under the firmament, from the waters, which was above the firmament. And it was so.
Okay, so that's what happened on the second day. See, that Moses was up here. Elohim is showing him this, all right? Now, get in Genesis, I think it's waiting for the 7th day is. In Genesis, quickly, because I'm out of time here. The 7th day.
I think it's 32.
Yeah. 32. Thus the heavens and the earth were complete and all their hosts. And on the seventh day, Elohim completed his work, which he had made, and he rested on the seventh day from all his work.
And he rested on the seventh day from all his work. Why? Go back to Exodus 24:16.
Exodus 24:16. And the glory of Yahweh abode upon Mount Sinai, and the cloud covered it 6 days. And the seventh day he called unto Moses out of the midst of the cloud.
Okay, now on the seventh day, after those 6 days, since 6 days that Moses is up there, he's been, go back to Genesis first chapter, and you see those 6 days that Elohim is showing him in the cloud. And then on the seventh day he rested. Why? Because she just read it. On the seventh day he called Moses out of the midst of the cloud. You see my point? Now he's up here. Keep reading.
And the midside of the glory of Yahweh was like devouring fire on the top of the mount in the eyes of the children of Israel. And Moses went into the midst of the cloud and dug him up into the mount, and Moses was in the mount 40 days and 40 nights.
Now he's up there 40 days and 40 nights. Now we have accounted for 7 of those days of what happened to him while he's up there. Now we have to account for the other 33 days. 25 and 8.
And let them make me a sanctuary, that I may dwell among them, according to all that I show thee, after the pattern of the tabernacle, and the pattern of all the instruments thereof, even so shall you make it.
Okay, now that's this pattern that you see here. More illustrated here, that they were told to build out in the wilderness, okay? They were told to build that, and see, this is a pattern, as we said, Paul said, this is a pattern of heavenly things. Because, I don't know why I'm out of the picture, thank you. This is a pattern of heavenly things, okay? Meaning this, that Yahweh gave them specific instructions on how to make this pattern. Yahweh only gave man 3 things to make. He gave him the pattern to make, gave instructions, gave Noah instructions on how to build an ark. See, through David, Solomon received instructions on how to build this temple. They're all divinely given. So when people sit up and say, well, God told me to build a church, you know, the first thing you should ask, show me the blueprints. Because that's what he did right here. Why would he change? See what I'm saying? But now, this pattern is a pattern of heavenly things. As we said earlier, we read in 1 John 5 and 7, that the blood, the water, and the spirit, that's manifested in this tabernacle pattern. There are 7 steps in this pattern. The gate, brazen altar and sin sacrifice, brazen laver, cup of holy anointing on the door. 5th step is this holy place with the seven brass candlestick for light, table of shewbread for bread, altar of incense, mediator, the 7th departmental veil of blue, purple, and scarlet, 6th step. The 7th step is this Ark of the Covenant with the 2 archangels on top of the mercy seat. Because that cloud that led them out of Egypt, see, they built the tabernacle for it. That cloud would fill this tabernacle and sit on the mercy seat. I think that's in there. 34. Yeah. Exodus 40:34, quickly.
Then a cloud covered the tent of the congregation, and the glory of Yahweh filled the tabernacle.
See, here's that illustration here. See, it says cloud covered the tabernacle, and then it filled this tabernacle, and see, and the cloud went in and sat on that mercy seat. Okay, read.
And Moses was not able to enter into the tent of the congregation, because the cloud abode thereon, and the glory of Yahweh filled the tabernacle. And when the cloud was taken up from over the tabernacle, the children of Israel went onward in all of their journey.
In other words, when this cloud moved, the Levites who were commissioned to serve in this tabernacle, they would have to break this down. See, the articles had rings, they would get stains, they would put it in the rings, they would lift it up, and the cloud went that way, they followed the cloud. It's no different with your tabernacle. Right. Your brain is made out of gray and white matter, which is likened to a cloud. And when your brain says move, your body follows.
Right.
Just like the Israelites did. Okay? So now, there's anything else I can bring up. That's pretty much the tenets. I guess we did kind of cover it a little bit, because we covered the names, and we wanted to show you the different manifestations of the name. Romans 1:19 and 20, just throw that in there. And see, and we also talked about the institution and the fulfillment. The institution of these carnal ordinances came back here with Moses. Yahshua is the fulfillment of those carnal ordinances. And then there's a tabernacle pattern. See, threefold. That's why these illustrations you see are threefold. Like this tabernacle pattern, because all things go according to the pattern. Quickly. Romans 1:19 and 20.
Romans 1:19-20.
Mm-hmm.
Because that which may be known of Yahweh is manifest in them,
mm-hmm.
for Yahweh has showed it unto them. For the invisible things of him from the creation of the world
mm-hmm.
are clearly seen, being understood by the things that are made.
So the invisible things, or things that are spiritual, they can be understood because they're a reflection of things that are made. In other words, the things you see are a reflection of things that are invisible. Simple. To understand a spiritual birth, understand a natural birth. To understand a spiritual death, understand a natural death. What is a type of the other? Okay, continue.
Even his eternal power and supernal nature, so that they are without excuse.
So that you don't have an excuse, okay? See, the supernal nature, we went through that, the Father, the Son, the Holy Spirit. And these three are one. See, and witnessed by the evidence in the earth, the Spirit, the Word, and the Blood, and these three agree in one. And see, and transmutation, see, his eternal power is the power of transmutation, because that's what Spirit does. It transmutes from one state to another. See, matter and spirit materialize, okay? Anything else I can bring up? We were talking about the Spirit, the Word, and the Blood that's manifested in the tabernacle. See, got blood here, got water here, cup of holy oil at the door that symbolizes Spirit. Okay, and that's represent. I'll throw this in here while we've got a couple of minutes. Hebrews. 1 Corinthians 15:3.
First Corinthians 15:3. Lest any should say that I were baptized in my name.
1 Corinthians 15:3.
For I delivered unto you first of all that which I also received, how that the Messiah died for our sins according to the Scriptures.
He died for our sins. That's a death. See, death is synonymous with blood. Read.
And that he was buried. And that he rose.
And that he was buried.
And that he rose.
Stop.
Again.
Burial, which is a type of water, same as water. Now you can read.
And then he rose again the third day, according to the Scriptures.
Resurrection. That will be spirit. See? Death is synonymous with blood, burial is synonymous with water, resurrection is synonymous with spirit. You see these principles exhibited throughout the Bible, especially in the Old Testament. How much time I got on the machine over there, Joe? Look down there. Look down there.
155?
What does it say?
155.
155? Okay, I can do this. I think I can. And I'll be done. Genesis, because I need to show, I just want to clearly show this point. Genesis 21. Quickly.
Genesis 21:9. And Sarah saw the son of Hagar the Egyptians, which he had borne unto Abraham, mocking. Wherefore she said unto Abraham, cast out this bondwoman and her son,
mm-hmm.
for the son of this bondwoman shall not be heir with my son, even with Isaac. And the things was very grievous in Abraham's sight because of his son. And Elohim said unto Abraham, Let it not be grievous in thy sight because of the land, and because of thy bondwoman, and all that Sarah hath said unto thee. Hearken unto her voice, for in Isaac shall thy seed be called. And also the son of the bondwoman will I make a nation, because he is thy seed. And Abraham rose up early in the morning, and took bread and a bottle of water, and gave it unto Hagar, putting it on her shoulder, and the child, and sent her away. And she departed, and wandered in the wilderness of Beersheba. And the water was spent in the bottle, and she cast the child under one of the shrubs, and she went and sat her down over against him a good way off, as it were a bow shot. For she said, Let me not see the death of the child. And she sat over against him, and lifted up her voice and wept. And Elohim heard the voice of the lad, and the angel of Elohim called to Hagar out of heaven, and said unto her, What aileth thee, Hagar? Fear not, for Elohim hath heard the voice of the lad where he is. Arise, lift up the lad, and hold him in thy hand, for I will make him a great nation.
Okay, now see, now this is a perfect example of the death, burial, and resurrection. Because see, she, as far as she was concerned, Ishmael was dead, was as good as dead. So she took him and she buried him or hid him under a shrub and walked away. As far as she was concerned, he was dead and buried. But an angel went and told her, go back and see the child. Lift the child up. See, lift the child up. That's a resurrection. A death, a burial, a resurrection.
Right.
See, why? Because it's pointing toward him.
Right.
Remember, the book is written of me.
Right.
It's pointing to him. His death, burial, resurrection. These are the things we talk about. These are the things that you see depicted on these charts. And if you come and study with us, you'll learn these things and much, much more. Thank you very much for your time and your patience. And with those few words, praise Yahshua.
To study with us. I hope something was said to inspire you to come back and study with us. We hold classes every Tuesday night and Thursday night from 7:30 to 9:30, and on Sundays from 11 to 1. Every fourth Sunday of the month, we have a Spanish class from 9:30 to 9:45. Any donations will be accepted by our treasurer, Eunice Reiser. Let's all stand and be dismissed. Now unto him that is able to keep you from falling, present you faultless with the presence of his glory with exceeding joy. To the only wise Elohim, our Savior, to Yahshua, Messiah, our Sovereign, belong glory and majesty, dominion and power, both before all times, now and forever. Let us all say
hallelujah.
You
should do that before you move. This was the...
So I hope you enjoyed this.
Yes, thank you.
You're welcome.
Why do you have a shirt?
Because she gave it to me.
Oh, yeah.
He passed away a few years ago.
Oh. All right.
Thank you. I'll tell her I got another compliment.
Yeah.
I don't know what's
up with her.
She's getting by, but she's...